If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
You want to see me go off? You have me talk to Ruben. That's my fucking...
I hope so. I'm always trying to get you to go off, man. Always.
Lots of promises.
No, you're not trying to do that. You always say get off. You always want to see me get off.
No.
That's
different. I always want to see that. You go off. All behind the scenes, and then I'll see me get on the mics, and then all PC Sal comes out.
Yeah.
Hello. I like mayonnaise.
You know what's funny?
What?
I do.
I know you do. Yeah, you're a mayonnaise-eating son of a bitch.
Mayonnaise is... delicious. I actually put it on my French fries.
Mayonnaise is horrible.
Do you? I know. I've seen you dip in your fries.
What is wrong with you? You're not even English.
What?
English? They love like vinegar and mayonnaise.
Vinegar is what they do. Yeah, the mayonnaise. Oh,
mayonnaise too. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, whatever.
Yeah, French fries.
It's part of Europe, so technically I'm still right.
Have you always been a big mayo eater? Or is that something you recently have found? Because.
No, that's, what do you mean, have I always? First off, I don't, it's not like I eat mayonnaise all the time.
You say like, oh, everybody dips their fries in mayo.
It's so common. Yeah.
And we're in Europe, aren't we?
Huh?
I said, and we're in Europe,
well,
aren't
no, I'm just saying that Europeans do it, so I'm not the only one that, that does it. I'm not saying it's better either, I'm just saying it's a different way of
doing
it.
So back to my question, have you always done this, or is this something that you started, what point did you start dipping your fries in mayo?
Right.
Has mayo been a big part
since
of-
Since I was a child.
You prefer that to ketchup.
Yeah, since I was a
really?
Child. Yeah, ketchup is just sugar. It's sugar tomato.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It is, it's the sugar pasty.
It's just sugar tomato. Yeah. And listen, you know, here's the thing. Like,
what's mayo all made of?
Mayonnaise is not any better. I mean, it's not that much better.
It's
soybean oil and egg yolks.
White.
Actually, if you get real mayonnaise, you get real mayonnaise made with real egg yolks. It's fucking, it's really good.
Well, best,
it's not that bad.
Best food sells real mayonnaise. That's actually their label, bro.
Finally.
Yeah, that's actually the label.
Yeah.
Yep.
It was a real mayonnaise.
So is mayonnaise considered a brain-enhancing food group?
Absolutely.
Oh, you like that transition.
It's absolutely not a brain-enhancing food.
No?
Mm. You can buy... paleo mayonnaise. I think, you know what?
They make avocado mayo. What is that?
You know where you can get really good mayonnaise? Thrive Market's got really good mayonnaise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you could get their...
No, they have the avocado mayo. We've ordered it from there already.
And that's really good. And that's I like to put that on my pizza.
What?
No, I'm just kidding.
You do such strange things.
I'm just kidding.
I can't keep up.
I thought I'd throw some crazy shit out.
Now, when I was a kid, you know, we grew up, you know, on bologna.
You did? You grew up? Me too.
Bologna on bologna and mayo.
I'm
still that was a staple. That was a staple lunch my mom tried to make
us
eat.
So bologna, mayonnaise,
part of why I'm skinny
bread.
Is because I didn't eat any of that shit. I stayed away from all that.
So you had bologna, mayonnaise, and white bread?
Yeah.
And that was your sandwich?
Iron kids.
I mean, that's,
what about,
that's a balanced meal.
What about you, Justin?
What?
Did you have bologna, mayonnaise, and white bread sandwiches?
No, I didn't have nasty meat like that.
What did you have?
I just ate like peanut butter and jelly. That was like my staple,
and
dude.
Juice boxes.
Like all the time.
I can see you sucking a Capri Sunday with your
I mean, you're visualizing
it. I can see you're eating a peanut butter and jelly sandwich with peanut butter on your cheeks.
I mean, it's getting all over my face.
Can you not see Justin?
And my hands.
Oh, yeah.
And it's dripping in my lap.
I would pay money to see that.
Yeah.
I would totally pay money. I used to have a lot of bologna and cheese.
Charge.
Bologna and cheese sandwiches. Here's a question. Okay, this is fucking, we got to talk about this. This is very important.
Fine.
I realized this as a child. You are either a cut your sandwich in half this way,
right.
Lengthwise, or a cut your sandwich in half diagonal.
Diagonal.
You're one of the other.
Karate chop it.
You're not both. You're either one or the other. Which one?
Or you're a crust kid that like cuts the crust off.
Oh,
remember that kid? That was a weird kid.
That kid
ended up
becoming
a psycho killer.
No, see, it's okay for a woman.
You're a psycho killer if you do that.
So did you cut your sandwich diagonally or straight down?
Diagonally. Kasha!
Did you make that noise too when you did
yeah,
it?
Yeah, I like would chop it down.
What about you, Adam?
Yeah. Diagonally.
You did diagonally too?
Yeah. Well,
I went straight down.
This
explains
a lot.
A lot.
Yeah, it does explain a lot.
Very, very, very.
Yeah.
Interesting.
I feel like diagonally is
popular.
Diagonally is the right way.
No, it creates two triangles. What the fuck is that?
Huh?
If you cut it in half all the way down,
that's geometry.
What you've done is you've created two sandwiches. What you guys have done is create two triangles with pointy edges.
Right.
It's just not.
It's way easier to eat.
It's way easier
from
to
an
eat.
from an evolutionary standpoint.
Square and whole. It's gonna hit you.
I'm trying to throw. Some
I got stuff. Nice pointy edges that go like right in.
Anyway, listen. Here's the deal.
You're wrong on this.
This
one,
is
sir.
Actually what you're about to listen to is a very smart episode.
I know.
Contrary to the intro that you just heard. No, we had Max Lugavere on the show, who's author of Genius Foods, and he's making the rounds right now because this book is, it should be out, right? Is
hey,
it out?
No, well, it's out now because this will go live.
When the book is out.
Yeah, this goes live on Wednesday, and the book just came out
yesterday. I wish my parents had read this book.
Yeah. No, this is...
So he has an interesting story. So he had a mother stricken with a type of dementia. He's a journalist with a biology background, and he went deep in study to figure out, like, how do we prevent, you know, these degenerative disorders from happening? And this book is all about how to maximize the health of your brain through diet. And there's some crazy stuff that's coming out. There's a recent study that he talks about in this episode where they actually showed how diet can be efficacious for depression. This is a 2017 study. Mm-hmm. He talks about how inflammation plays a role in all of that, how Alzheimer's is type 3 diabetes, which we've referenced before in the past.
We get into why babies are fat. Wonder why your kid's fat?
Yeah, no, not your kid.
Yeah,
like a baby.
Yeah, dude, that was probably one of the most mind-blowing things that he dropped. I mean, he dropped all kinds of little, bombs.
Yeah,
he dropped a bunch of nugget bombs in there today.
Yeah.
I make stuff up and it sticks.
He's been on Dr. Oz, four or five times already? So he's been on the Rubin Report. So he's making the rounds, man.
Yeah, yeah. And he's, me and him became best friends very quickly.
Yeah.
Very, very similar.
Very similar background.
Very similar story and background.
Yes, it's very familiar.
But anyway, you will enjoy this episode. It's a great conversation about nutrition. His book is fascinating. You can find his book at geniusfoodsbook.com. You can find him on Instagram at Max Lugavere. That's Lugavere.
I highly recommend his Instagram. His Instagram is a cleaner version of like what Sal likes to do, his helpies, where he puts long posts and he has a terrible image.
Right.
This guy actually puts really good images that are bits of information and drops a lot of knowledge. His Instagram is
full. We appreciate the nipple hair.
Yeah, absolutely.
What? Sal. Oh. Yeah. If you want to know what
Not
he's talking
Max.
About, go to my
know.
Instagram
I haven't
page.
Seen, I haven't seen his page yet.
Absolutely. Right. Also, listen, this month we're giving out access to our forum for free for enrolling in any of our fitness or MAPS bundles. By the way, if you don't know what MAPS programs are, here's a quick rundown. If you want to build maximum muscle, MAPS Anabolic, that's the program you want to do. If you want to build a functional physique, like an athlete, that's MAPS Performance. If you want to train like a bodybuilder or sculpt your physique like a bikini competitor, that's MAPS Aesthetic. If you want to work out at home or on the road without equipment, so just using your body weight, well, that's MAPS Anywhere. And then for correctional exercise purposes, especially if you're a personal trainer. Look, if you're a personal trainer, you need to get the Prime bundle so that you can help train your clients.
You need
And finally, he actually mentions how high intensity interval training has been shown to increase the density of mitochondria in the cells of the body. That's the powerhouse of the cells of the body. And it's a lot of scientists now are saying that that is the key to longevity, health, and performance. We also have a HIIT program, our MAPS HIIT program, which you can get. And you can get all of this, by the way, at mindpumpmedia.com. And if you get a bundle, you get access to our forum for free. So with that being said, without any further ado, here we are talking to Max Lugavere, author of Genius Foods.
Enjoy the show.
Tell us a little bit about your story. Let's start off with that first before we dive into some of the details, I should say.
Yeah, absolutely. So my background, I started as a journalist. My first job out of college was working for Al Gore. He co-founded a TV network that was available in 100 million homes in the U.S. called Current TV.
What was that like?
That was pretty crazy. That was...
Are you an Al Gore fan going into this?
Not necessarily.
Be honest, don't bullshit
No. Basically, when I started college, I was pre-med. I was a biology major. And then I realized that I had a love of storytelling and creativity. And I also struggled all throughout my schooling with executive function. I was always in the gifted program, but I always it was really difficult for me to get good grades. And so even though I had a passion always for science and health, actually dating back to like my sophomore year of high school, I didn't think that I had the ability to keep up with the academic rigor that medical school would ultimately require. And so then I also ended up really falling in love with film and cinema and documentary filmmaking and music. And so halfway through college, I switched my major to double major in film and psychology. And I didn't know what I was going to do when I graduated college. I knew that I liked storytelling. I knew that I had a passion for things that could, you know, stories that could ultimately make the world a better place. I've always been a very empathetic and compassionate person. But I didn't know how that would pan out in terms of a career. I was lucky enough to have parents that kind of just you know, encouraged me to do what I loved, which I think is rare. Mm-hmm. But one day when I was walking around the communication center of my college, University of Miami, there was a poster advertising this network, this TV network that Al Gore was launching with partners that was going to seize the reins of traditional media and give it back to the youth. Okay.
Oh, that sounds exciting.
Super exciting. Yeah. Super exciting.
How old are you at this point? How old are you?
So I was like 22.
Oh, okay. It's called the internet.
Yeah. Well, but this was so back then, okay, it was not that long ago, but MySpace was still like the social network to be on, right? And YouTube had yet to really become a phenomenon. So for me, it was like this amazing, credible platform to tell stories. The idea was they were going to give like 50 kids cameras and laptops to go around the world and shoot stories that were, you know, entertainment first, but also could make the world a better place.
Oh, that's rad.
And yeah, I thought it was amazing. I thought it was a dream job. So I threw myself at the network along with thousands of other kids around the U.S. And I was one of the only ones to get a full-time job, essentially. It was like a dream job where they ended up moving me out to L.A., putting me on TV and giving me the reins to essentially work with Peabody Award-winning journalists and storytellers.
Dude, what was that process?
Were you intimidated?
Yeah. What was that? Yeah, what was that process like?
I mean, it was nuts. I was on national TV from the minute I graduated college until about 2011.
Fuck, I'd be scared to death at that age.
Yeah, it was insane. I mean, imagine leaving college literally and then winding up in the makeup chair every single day to get like TV-friendly, you know, and like, it was just insane. It was insane. But well, it was.
How did you deal with that? Did you ever feel like did you get scared? I mean, did you have moments too where your ego blew up? I mean, what did you go through with that? I mean, at a young age to drop into that, that's different. Dude. Yeah. That's not like most people that.
It's scary. It's scary as hell. Even it would scare the hell out of me now. Did you feel like, okay, this is my purpose and that's what drove you? Or was it conflicting with being afraid of doing it?
I didn't know. I mean, I definitely didn't have an aspiration of being on camera in college. I didn't want to be an actor or anything like that. I just knew that throughout my life, I've, you know, been able to go really deep in certain topics. And when I found topics like that over the course of my life, I knew that I really liked to talk about them. So for, you know, one of the most salient passions of mine has always been health. And so I've always enjoyed really talking to people about health. And I recognize that throughout, you know, college and whatever, people would always come to me with their health questions. And that's just sort of a pattern that emerged. I never had any professional aspiration. But when I landed this opportunity to talk about my passions on TV and have a show where I could really curate topics and really be a generalist in that sense, you know, it was, I guess, a little intimidating. I definitely learned a lot over the course of the process, but I also tried to use it as a funnel for things that I felt could leave my audience better off. I really, and like you guys, like I feel like when you have a platform, you've got to kind of think about yourself as being in the service of the audience, you know?
Completely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And of course I learned that over the, you know, there were certain things that were not intuitive to me that I ended up learning. So for example, when I first went on camera, I thought that your audience would like you the cooler you made yourself sound, you know, which obviously the exact opposite is true,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, because you're not vulnerable otherwise.
Right.
You got to look real. You got to seem real.
Yeah. I mean, these are not the kinds of things.
How did you put that together? What happened?
Well, what did it sound like? I want to hear that voice.
Well, it's just like, you know.
Hey, guys.
Hello, America.
Yeah. You just kind of want to make yourself seem like kind of a badass, but like really the way we now know as adults, like the way to actually be a badass is to be vulnerable and to be real and authentic, which I guess is kind of difficult to do when you're in a TV on a TV set, but yeah, I mean, there was a learning curve.
Did
I remember the first shot that went on air on Current? I was wearing shorts in this set on set basically, and because I was, you know, growing up, I loved wearing shorts, and so I would like kind of try to wear them whenever I could on TV, which is just. Rule number one, not a good idea. You don't want to wear shorts on TV.
Yeah.
But in this opening shot, I remember the camera was like, it was on a jib, which is essentially like a crane.
Right.
So they put the camera on a jib and it was like coming from a really low angle.
Oh, perfect.
And so you could literally see like all up my shorts. Like, yeah, male.
There's
hairy.
The nuts.
Yeah.
There's,
yeah.
Hey-o.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I mean, most downloaded video of all time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Those
very
are
popular.
Yeah. So those are the kinds of things that you learn.
Did you ever have like a paradigm shattering moment during that process that altered the way you acted on the show? Like where you afterwards you're like, fuck, that was embarrassing. I mean, obviously the shorts thing, but did you ever say something or become really super nerve wracking going into it? Do you have moments like that?
I think, you know, one of the big things for me was to know that when the camera's on, you've got to sort of be, a higher energy version of yourself. I mean, sometimes I remember I would roll into set just after waking up and I would be kind of like, my voice, it's deep. So sometimes it can be a bit, it can sound a bit monotone, even though internally I'm feeling like excited. Yeah. I realize that, that doesn't, you know, sometimes I need to kind of, articulate, what's the word? Like just using more tonality, I guess, or something like that.
Inflections.
Yeah, inflections, things like that helps. I mean, these are things that kind of, after a while, came intuitively to me, but...
No, that's such a great point that I think you're kind of grazing over is when we started interviewing all these people that had either been on TV or like YouTube stars, something that I made a connection really quick and early on was, holy shit, these guys and girls are totally different in person than as soon as like the camera comes on.
Oh yeah, they turn it on.
And some of them were like complete opposite personalities off camera, and they just have this ability that once they turn their phone facing them or the cameras come on, all of a sudden their this lively changes, personality like, comes out, and it was like, whoa. But it makes so much sense because the person on the other side that's receiving that, they feel that energy, that excitement, that animation in the person. Like, so that makes a big difference.
Yeah, I think that's part of it. And I think really what it ultimately comes down to is just having a level of respect for your audience and not talking down to them, not dumbing down your content, really valuing the attention that they're paying to you. I mean, attention is sort of like the new limited resource, right? And so I just, working with the president of programming at Current, who was sort of a mentor to me, I really just learned to make everything that I do to be in the service of the audience. And actually, and I've taken all of those learnings and I continue to use them today. So for example, I made a switch recently, not to get off topic, but I made a switch recently in how I approach Instagram. And I basically realized that for a while I was using Instagram to basically post pictures of myself where I was looking cool, which I think is how a lot of people use Instagram. And I was like posting, you know, I might be able to nail a caption here and there, but posting pictures of myself is not, I'm not doing this in the service of the audience. I'm doing this because I want the dopamine hit of getting likes on this photo. And so a couple months ago, I decided, look, I'm just going to like start creating infographics where I can really give people bite-sized, digestible information, because my goal is to help people, you know, with health literacy, help them make switches in their lives that are going to help them be healthier. And so that, I would say, is a direction that really stems from those early days at Current TV.
Awesome. So how was Al Gore, dude? I mean, Sal's a huge fan, so I want to know what you think about him.
Not at all.
He's he was definitely a great boss. Like I got to see him every year at the company parties and big staff meetings. The network wasn't the Al Gore network. It was a network. He was actually very hands off when it came to programming. It wasn't.
Did you have any say into what you would be covering and stuff? Was there a lot of flexibility there?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, they gave me free rein. So completely. I was basically, I was hired by the president of programming of Current because I embodied who the network was ultimately seeking to empower.
Oh, I see.
So when I was an undergraduate at University of Miami, I made a short documentary that was the first ever film that I'd made, where I was ranting about hedonism and spirituality. That was my student film. That's what I was really into when I went to University of Miami. I was trying to reconcile the fact that I've always had a seeker's mentality about spirituality, yet I always found it to be a source of cognitive dissonance for me that religious traditions have always said that to find enlightenment, you've got to deny the pleasures of the flesh. You've got to, you know, either walk across coals, lie down on nails, not have sex until marriage. To me, as an undergraduate, really entering adulthood for the first time in South Beach, I was like, wait a minute, there's got to be a better way to find quote unquote.
How can
God.
I get around this?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So as an undergraduate, I made this short film where I was like ranting to the camera about basically about that. I was obsessed with a philosopher named Jiddu Krishnamurti who talked a lot about this stuff, about how truth is really a pathless land and you really have to find it through your own self-experimentation, you know, spiritually. We talk about self-experimentation today in terms of health and fitness, but he's really the ultimate guru when it comes to self-experimentation in terms of spiritual truth. He's sort of like the anti-guru. So I was like kind of obsessed with this guy and his work. And so I made this documentary. I was in front of the camera and the film portrayed me basically as being the ultimate one-man band storyteller with something to say. And Current TV, the network, saw it and they were like, look, this is like a young, passionate storyteller. This is who we're ultimately, he embodies who we're ultimately trying to empower. And they gave me this job. And that really is a pattern that, as I mentioned, you know, I've always had throughout my life. When I get passionate about something, all I want to do is talk about it and bring people with me along for the journey. And that, yeah. So I mean,
do you find yourself getting obsessive about topics?
I do. My brain is like a light switch. Yeah. So I'm either not interested in it or I'm completely obsessed with it and I can't sleep until I feel like I've got some sort of grasp over it.
Mm. I think everybody here can identify with that.
Oh, man. There you go. So much. You're saying that. I'm like, yep. How did the obsession with health start?
So, yeah, I've been really interested in health from high school. So my I was a shy computer programmer introvert. In college, I had bad hair. I wore braces. I really gravitated to computers and programming, and I also had a mutual passion for comic books and superheroes. And one day,
were a hit with the ladies.
I was a big hit with the ladies.
Panties dropping all over the place.
Yeah. I wasn't into sports. I was always terrible at any kind of athleticism.
And here I thought him and I were going to connect the most, but I think it might be you.
Yeah, he's like me right now. Yeah,
well, you're describing Sal right now.
Well, but here's the really.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So I was, I went to high school in Manhattan in New York City, and close to my high school, one day I discovered a supplement store. It was a mom and pop supplement store near my high school. And I walked in one day and there was a guy behind the counter who was always there and he was very knowledgeable. And I saw the supplements on the wall as sort of being, in a way, like these sort of potions that could help me transcend my nerdiness as a school kid, you know, almost in a way that could like make me a superhero. And that sort of connected with my interest in like in programming. I found many of the same feedback loops that were there in programming were evident were present in working out. And I became really interested in bodybuilding. Actually in high school. And so much so that my senior thesis in high school, I actually wrote a 12-page dissertation on creatine and the benefits of creatine. And I was like really nerdy for this.
For sure, Sal, bro.
So yeah. For yeah. sure, so Sal. Bodybuilding, yes. creatine. Yeah.
I think we just became
Check
best friends.
In. That's awesome. Yeah. I mean, no, these are not the kinds of things that I could talk about with girls, especially on a first date, or most girls that I know. But
well,
or at least new in high school. So yeah. Now I know a lot of really cool girls that I can talk about this to. But yeah, needless to say, I became obsessed. I was working out all the time. I was trying all kinds of crazy diets. I became obsessed with a book that I discovered it was probably 11th grade, written by Lyle McDonald on the ketogenic diet. So I became obsessed with this topic like very early on. So I've always been.
Wow, you read a book on keto in what year is that?
That was 1998.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. Way ahead of a lot of people for sure.
Yeah. And I mean, I read the
Dave
book.
Dave Palumbo was a bodybuilder that used to advocate for ketogenic diets back in the late 90s, too.
But not a lot of people talking about it back then. It was nowhere near as
although the keto diet's been around for such a long time, you know, it's, I mean, that was before it became cool.
Exactly. So I've been into this for a very long time. And no, you know, I mean, other than starting college as a pre-med, I had no professional, you know, I wasn't sure how I was going to use this. It was really just a personal passion. It made me feel good. I recognized the mental health benefits of it. But yeah, I sort of carried this passion for health and science with me all throughout life. You know, I was from an early age familiar with PubMed and how to find research whenever I had health questions. And at Current TV, which was my first real job out of college, whenever I had the opportunity to shine a light on health-related topics, whether it was, you know, new science findings or how technology was beginning to augment health in really interesting ways, I would seize that opportunity. When I left Current TV to try to figure out where I was going to go with my career, I was in my, I guess, late 20s. This was... 2008 around or 2000, mm-hmm. maybe 2000, no, sorry, 2011. It was then in my personal life that I was starting to spend more and more time back home where I'm from in New York, where my mom and my brothers live. And I was starting to spend more and more time around my mom. And my mom started to show very early signs of memory loss. And what would ultimately be revealed were the earliest symptoms of a very niche form of dementia. And
what did this look like? Because I think, you know, most people experience the I forgot, you know, where I put my keys type of deal. But this was this might have been this was different.
Yeah.
I'm assuming.
Yeah. If you forget where your keys are, that's normal. If you forget what your keys are for, that's a sign that you need to go see a doctor.
That's a good point.
Yeah. So basically it had seemed like, I mean, my mom's processing speed had downshifted severely. She began complaining of brain fog, which is not something I'd ever heard her complain about in the past. I mean, my mom was what I would consider today a high performer. If I knew her when she was my age, I mean, she ran a successful business in the 80s and 90s that she launched with my dad, who was her husband at the time. She raised three kids. She was always very passionate about learning and self-education. And at a certain point, my mom, you know, still blonde, still youthful, still vibrant. It had just seemed as if, you know, talking to her was different. When I would be in the kitchen with her cooking a meal, for example, and I'd ask her to pass the salt if she were standing next to the cabinet where a spice, you know, happened to be, I'd ask her to pass it. It would take her 5 seconds to even process that command before she would begin to respond to it. Where if I tell you to pass me something, you hear it, you respond instantly.
Mm-hmm.
It would be quicker for me to actually traverse the kitchen and reach into the cabinet and grab it myself. Like you're talking to, we kind of intuitively know when we're talking to much older people mm-hmm. that their processing speed is not what, you know, is not that of a younger person or even a person in middle age. But it almost seemed as if talking to my mom, I was talking to an elderly person. And this was
this sudden?
It was pretty sudden. Mm. And it coincided with a change to her gait, which is the way that she walks. So my mom, you know, like any New Yorker, walks pretty fast. My mom has never had a driver's license. She walks everywhere. And it had seemed as if her stride had sort of shortened.
Now, being somebody who's in health and understands, or at least because you had a passion for the human body, when you noticed these things, was it like, oh shit, were you terrified right away, or were you...
Or did that send you down the rabbit hole of learning?
No, not yet. So I thought actually initially that, first of all, I thought my mom's movement problems were just because of the fact that she hadn't really ever worked out throughout her life. Mm. She really didn't have the same kind of value of exercise that I think people have today. So I was like, Mom, get to the gym, you know, maybe do some stretching. I had no concept that how a person moves could be related to their brain function. Mm. Of course, now I know otherwise. But yeah, it wasn't for me until a family trip to Miami to visit my dad. My parents were divorced at this time, and this was one of the few cases where my mom and my brothers, we all sort of descended on Miami, and my mom and my dad remained friends, so we would stay with my dad occasionally, and this was one of those times. We're all in Miami, and we're all in the living room, and the living room's connected to the dining room. There's a big breakfast bar that separates the two. And we were all sort of sitting there, and my mom, to the whole family, announced that she had been having memory problems. I mean, previous to that, it was just sort of something that she might have mentioned under her breath to me or in passing. And that she had also started seeing a neurologist. And this, to me, sounded, I guess, a little bit more serious. But then my dad, who can be a little bit sardonic at times, chimed in and asked my mom, well, if you're having memory problems, how could you be having memory problems? What year is it? And my mom had to think about it. She couldn't immediately tell us what year it was. And me and my brothers, we were so ignorant at the time, we kind of chimed in and we started to poke fun. I mean, imagine how horrible that is. We were just so in the dark. We're like, come on, Mom, how could you not know what year it is? And she started to cry in that moment. And that to me is like when everything changed. You know, I realized that something was seriously wrong with my mom, and I had to, essentially it was my call to action. I had to, really dedicate time to figuring out what this was. And because I was the only person in my family that really had an interest in health, I realized, and I also have, you know, thankfully a non-traditional job where I had the ability to kind of like take time away from my career to go with my mom. I knew that I had to start going with my mom to doctor's appointments. And still, I've, you know, even at this point, I had no idea what I was in for. But I went with my mom to a neurologist at NYU. Really hard to, you know, come to any sort of conclusion. I mean, they did MRI tests, but my mom wasn't diagnosed with anything. We ended up going to Columbia University, which is also in New York City, one of the top neurology departments in the U.S. We went to Johns Hopkins in Baltimore. Ultimately, the journey culminated, at least for me, in a trip to the Cleveland Clinic. The Cleveland Clinic, I remember reading about, was known for taking a sort of all-hands-on-deck approach to people's health. People with very complicated medical problems end up going to the Cleveland Clinic because even before I had the definition of functional medicine, this to me was sort of what the promise of functional medicine today seems to be, is that they really take a root cause approach to try to figure out what the root cause is.
Isn't that amazing that we're kind of just now getting around to this?
Yeah, exactly. It's crazy. Because the way Western medicine operates, it's one pill for every ill. They basically treat the symptoms with pharmaceutical band-aids and they send you on your way.
Right. It's also extremely reductionist. It's, you know, they break everything down into such small pieces that it becomes impossible to find a root cause of anything, because many times the root cause is linked to so many different things.
Yeah, to another system of the body that they're not specialized
in. Or to all of them.
100%. Yeah, 100%. And that is absolutely the case for the brain, according to the latest and best available evidence. And, you know, I went to the Cleveland Clinic expecting it to be this cathedral to medical insight, right? Like, I mean, it's one of the top...
So you were hopeful. You were very hopeful.
Very hopeful. Very hopeful. And also, you know, I have a lot of respect for medicine. So, I mean, I was not... I wasn't going in as a skeptic. But... it was there that that my mom, for the first time, was diagnosed with a neurodegenerative disease. And we were in a renowned neurologist's office, and he ran a battery of physical and cognitive tests on my mom. And without addressing diet or lifestyle once, he sent us on our way, essentially, with two prescriptions.
Was this your first experience of your diagnose and adios?
Yes. I refer to that a lot because that's what I experience in every single time. I mean, in no case, and even today, I continue to experience it with my mom, who's become essentially a walking pharmacy. But yeah, you know, doctors, the way the current medical paradigm is set up, and you guys, I'm sure, are familiar with this. You know, your average physician has less than 15 minutes to give to any one patient. So they don't take the time to talk about... Well, not only do they not take the time to talk about diet and lifestyle, but they don't know much about it. So we go to these doctors and we're scared and confused, expecting them to be experts in all things health and wellness, but they're not experts when it comes to nutrition. They're not. You know, they get an afternoon of medical training.
Yeah, or exercise, right?
And they'll
or exercise. Two arguably the most important things that you could probably apply.
Exactly, exactly.
In fact, many times if you bring up nutrition and exercise, they'll get scoffed at. Many times, if you go with a skin condition or a mental issue or a degenerative disease, and you say, "Hey, what about diet?" and they'll say, "It has no effect."
Yeah, sure, you can do that, but
100%. Yeah, I like to say, you know, that people, you know, first of all, I think science literacy is so important, and I like to remind people that, you know, it's good to be a skeptic. Okay, what's not good is to be a cynic. And what I find is that so many of these doctors have just been put through the medical school ringer. It's not even their fault, really. It's not that there's some kind of, you know, malevolent thing going on where doctors are just trained to shit on, you know, alternative approaches. But medical school is really hard. Most doctors, you know, end up coming out at the other end of the tunnel with depression and mental health problems themselves. And there's way more... you know, doctors today spend at least 50% of their time doing administrative work to make, you know, to meet their financial needs. So it's just like, it's just a systemic problem. And I found, you know, in most cases when bringing up diet in these doctor's offices, that they end up being way more cynical than they should be. They just, you know, they're down on what they're not up on.
When you went that time and they gave your mom those two medications and you left, were you okay, hopeful? Were you thinking like, okay, here we go, this is going to help? Or were you like, no, I need to look deeper?
Yeah, well, I mean, the first thing that I did, which I think anybody would do, is I took out my smartphone and I Googled the prescriptions, because these are drugs that I'd never heard of before. And what I realized, actually, it wasn't even, you know, the word Alzheimer's disease and dementia wasn't even brought up in that neurologist's office. And yet my mom was prescribed one of the two drugs was for Alzheimer's disease. And that to me is when, I mean, that was the first time in my life I'd ever had a panic attack, because I started really looking into what these drugs do, and I realized that they have no disease-modifying effect. They're of limited efficacy, and
they're basically what, dopamine or neurotransmitter boosters, or
exactly. So what they do is, the gold standard drug for Parkinson's disease is basically like a
is it levodopa?
Yes.
Is that the name? Okay.
Yeah, levodopa and carbidopa. It's called Sinemet, and it basically is a dopamine replacement for the brain, because in Parkinson's disease, dopaminergic neurons in the region of the brain associated with that disease involved in movement begin to die. And by the first time you show your first Parkinson's symptom, 50% of those neurons are already dead.
So by the time, when you see symptoms, you're already down the, I mean, you've already gone down the path now.
Well, they say it with like 20, 30 years, right? That's when it normally starts for like Alzheimer's and things like that?
Yes, exactly.
Wow.
Exactly.
And so that was diagnosed with Alzheimer's and dementia at this point?
She was diagnosed with dementia and a Parkinsonian syndrome. She wasn't diagnosed with Alzheimer's, but she had the symptoms of both. Mm. She had the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease, which is a memory disorder, and she had symptoms that were more Parkinsonian in nature. So she was prescribed both drugs. No matter what variant of dementia you come in on, generally, if it's not a...
they'll give you the same thing.
They'll give you the same thing.
Yeah, because what they're saying, okay, these basically these receptors for dopamine are dead, so let's just boost the dopamine to get more out of the leftover receptors, which may actually accelerate the process sometimes, right? Don't the receptors sometimes get hammered and maybe even get worse later on? I know they lose their efficacy at some point where they do nothing for you at all.
Absolutely. So this is one of the problems with, or one of the, I guess, potential dangers of messing with your neurotransmitters is that the receptors for neurotransmitters become downregulated when they're flooded with neurotransmitter. And not only that, but if the drug isn't necessarily working, neurotransmitters are oxidative. So, I mean, one of the this drug, Sinemet, is actually a pro-oxidant. So if it's not actually working, then you shouldn't be on the drug.
This might be one of the cases where the medicine starts to become worse than the disease, almost.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the reasons why MDMA is so damaging, because it basically floods your synaptic cleft with your own serotonin, essentially burning away neurons, because serotonin actually produces oxidative stress. Mm. So,
but it's really fun.
But I've heard. And potentially useful.
So when did you start going down the path of, you know, I hate to use the word alternative, but, you know, other ways of helping your mom?
Well, so there was this weird moment where I realized that my mom's mom, my grandma, was 94 and healthy at the time. She was, you know, my grandmother's cognition was fine, and yet this disease that I had previously considered to be an old person's disease was sort of bubbling up in my mom. And so I had this hunch that there had to have been something that changed between my grandmother's generation and my mom's that led to my mom developing this condition. And my hunch, because I have a bias towards diet and lifestyle as being profoundly important when it comes to your health and how you feel, my theory was that there had to be something related to diet and lifestyle. And I started, I mean, immediately I went into PubMed and I started looking at potential dietary and lifestyle interventions. And also when I learned, so I learned that one of the reasons why these pharmaceutical drugs are so ineffective, and, you know, one of the reasons why 99.9 or 99.6% of Alzheimer's drug treatment trials fail is because, as you mentioned, Alzheimer's disease begins in the brain decades before the first symptom. So almost in tandem with my quest to see if there was anything out there that could help my mom, I became really interested in the notion of prevention. And this was because if you subtract 30 from my mom's age at the time, you get me. And I became really interested in doing whatever it is that I could do to prevent this from ever happening to myself.
Did that scare you when you kind of computed that in your head?
I mean, yeah, it was terrifying.
Right.
It was terrifying. I mean, I recognize that I've always been very health conscious and that I've always valued exercise and working out. And so, you know, I wasn't, I guess, immediately afraid. And also I figured, you know, what 30 years isn't exactly cause for concern. You know, that's a big window of opportunity for me to change my diet and do whatever I might be able to do to protect my brain. But alongside my research, I also remembered, you know, a couple of years prior, I had seen a TED talk by Terry Walls, a TEDx talk.
We had her on the show.
Oh, did you? Awesome.
Yeah. She's badass.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. I mean, it was sort of this, it's funny how, you know, foreshadowing it was that I actually really loved that TED Talk when I had watched it. But it's something that I remembered seeing when I started to think about like where I might go for clues as to how diet and lifestyle might affect brain function. I mean, obviously she talks about the role of diet and lifestyle in multiple sclerosis, but there was a lot less information out there at the time when I began researching this for diet and Alzheimer's disease, let alone other variants of dementia. So I just began looking and I stumbled upon this really interesting insight that relates Alzheimer's disease, which is the most common form of dementia, not necessarily what my mom had, but I figured that anything that pertains to Alzheimer's, I might be able to, you know, maybe glean and use on my mom, so to speak, particularly if it's a safe recommendation. And I stumbled upon this insight that Alzheimer's is related to type 2 diabetes.
Some scientists call it type 3 diabetes, in fact. They'll call Alzheimer's type 3 diabetes.
Crazy. Yeah, yeah. So the scientist who coined that term, Suzanne De La Monte at Brown University, I've been to her lab and I've interviewed her. And that was a really interesting and paradigm-shifting insight for me because, you know, type 2 diabetes, according to most experts that you'll ask, is a lifestyle disease brought on by a sedentary lifestyle, a diet that's become saturated with hyper-processed foods. And so even though my mom had never been diabetic, I was like, okay, what insights can I get from studies on metabolism? And use that to say, well, you know, if the metabolic health of the brain is related so closely to the metabolic health of the body, what insights might I glean? What actionable steps and foods and practices might I be able to take from the studies on metabolism that might potentially be able to help my mom? So there was a level of dot connecting there that I was making that I think most clinicians and even PhDs, for example, are not able to do because clinicians, you know, they think only in terms of evidence-based, you know, things that they can prescribe lest they have a malpractice suit waged against them. Right. And PhDs tend to lose sight of the forest for the trees because they're so focused on these really tiny niche topics. And we need both, right? So right. I'm not saying that there's anything...
This is where your journalism background probably really came in handy.
Yeah. And I think a level of creative thinking as well. Because, you know, like I had to learn all of these things from the ground up. And for me to be able to integrate them into a way that makes sense for me, that I can communicate effectively to people, I've got to be able to tell it like a story, like sort of a story of how we might, you know, protect our health so that we may enhance brain function and the like. So, so I started looking into like all these different areas. I was looking into metabolism. What are the latest diet studies and randomized control trials, which are the only kinds of trials that can actually prove cause and effect, say on diets that we might eat to improve metabolic health? I started looking at low fat versus, you know, low carb and became really interested there. I also started looking into the latest research and understanding of vascular health and how to prevent cardiovascular disease. Because even though, you know, you'll go see a cardiologist and you'll go see a neurologist and neither the twain shall meet, right? Because as you mentioned, you know, medicine typically takes such a reductionist approach. I was like, well, the brain is fed nutrients and fuel by a network of microvessels that if you were to take out of your brain and line end to end would stretch 400 miles long. So there's got to be something to say about nurturing vascular health. I mean, the second most common form of dementia is called vascular dementia, which is basically due to a series of strokes, microstrokes in the brain. But there are vascular issues at play too when it comes to Alzheimer's disease and likely the niche form of mental monstrosity that my mom had developed. So,
wow. So
I was just like putting all of these together and... Obviously, you know, like I said, my brain works like a switch. So I just became obsessed. I was losing sleep to hours and hours of research. I was digging into the primary literature. I was just, you know, doing everything I could to understand. And, you know, granted, I didn't have training as a scientist, but I did find that, it's very empowering that we live in a time where all of the world's knowledge is available to us at our fingertips. So not once did it seem to me to be sort of a barrier to finding the answers that I wanted, that I wasn't a medical doctor. I was like, we have PubMed, you know, many studies are available to us for free. I started reading the introductions to these studies, which provide context. I started reading the discussions, which provide a sort of English language analysis of what the results are of these studies. ultimately I ended up finding somebody who gave me their login to an academic portal so that I could download all research papers.
That's dope.
Yeah, nice. So I had access to all papers. It was like being a kid in a candy store, I swear to God.
Sounds like something Sal would get a boner over.
Oh, right. I have one right now. No, it's, you know, with, if you have the right...
I'm gonna scoot over a little bit.
Yeah. If you have the right motivation today, you can learn anything. I mean, we are seeing the emergence of citizen scientists and citizen doctors, and discoveries are being made right now through forums. I have family members who have chronic health issues who made discoveries through belonging to groups of people with these issues through their compiled anecdote or driving research now, which this wasn't the case before. So many barriers to be able to even read some of these things before, which no longer exists. So if you have the right motivation, which you definitely did, and you're a smart person, I mean, you can make some pretty incredible
discoveries. How receptive was she? Because one of the challenges I've always had is when I deal with someone who's close to me, and I don't know how familiar you might be with this one. So I have a best friend, man. We go all the way back to elementary school, and he has this disorder, or they can't even pin what it is, but he has these, he wakes up in the middle of the night and he acts out his dreams, and extremely and dangerous. Like, he'll jump off the bed, and there's been stories of people that have the same condition that will walk out of their window and shit like that, because they think they have a dream that the place is burning on fire, and they jump out, and it's really scary for them, and they've no one can quite put their finger on exactly what it is. And they say that like 98 or 95% of the people that go through this, like he's going through, end up with Parkinson's.
Hmm.
And so I've been trying to send him all this research around Parkinson's and then how to be preventative with a lot of it. And I just think that I feel his frustration, because I know he's going to all these medical doctors, and these doctors aren't able to tell him certainly what it is.
Yeah.
And so how was your mom? And I know what it's like to try and give this information to somebody. How's her attitude? Is she receiving it well? Is she willing to try everything, or are you struggling with that at all?
Yeah. So, I mean, initially there was some pushback, because obviously I'm my mom's son, you know,
right.
How could I possibly know more than her about nutrition, right? My mom grew up in a time when the nation was in a frenzy over what seemed like an epidemic of heart disease. Mm-hmm. So my mom's always been very attuned to the messaging from the government over the past 50 years about how a person might eat to prevent heart disease. So growing up, even though my mom was health conscious, even though my mom had access to healthy food, we always used corn oil. We always had margarine instead of butter. And, you know, my mom always... I never saw my mom eating eggs, but going through an entire bag of, you know, saturated fat-free potato chips, or an entire bag of pretzels, low-fat pretzels, would be completely fine.
Mm.
And, you know, if not, maybe even improve her health, is what she thought.
Right.
So me coming in and saying, Mom, you've got to reduce the carbohydrates, you've got to eat more fat, healthier fats, you've got to ditch the corn oil. Eggs are not going to kill you. In fact, eggs are really important when it comes to brain health. And there's no relationship for most people when it comes to dietary cholesterol and serum cholesterol. You know, it was kind of a hard sell for my mom, to say the least. But eventually, she started buying into these notions. She got rid of the corn oil, thankfully. I got rid of the bread and all that stuff in her house, which I think doesn't really serve anybody. You know, if you're metabolically healthy, I think bread is maybe benign. If you're working out a lot, obviously, and you've got bigger, more skeletal muscle, you can dispose of greater amounts of glucose. And if you're not gluten sensitive, I think fine. But to me, bread is the ultimate processed food masquerading as a health staple.
Right.
Oh
yeah. People don't realize like wheat needs to be extremely processed for us to even be able to eat it.
Exactly.
And not only that, you touched on a part that I think is most important that I've seen just in my 15 plus career of being in health and fitness, is the decline of movement.
Yeah.
I mean, the average client, I share this on our show all the time, that the average American is moving like 4,000 steps a day. That's not even a fucking 1 hour walk for the entire day. Like that, we're fucking lazy. We're not moving at all. And even people that exercise are still considered sedentary. So I think a lot of that has to do with it. I think, you know, 50 plus years ago, we were way more physical and way more active. So our bodies utilizing a lot of that, where now
food's so different too.
Oh.
So when you just touched on a few things with lower carbohydrate, more fat, you know, healthier fats, cholesterol is probably good for you when you consume it. When you're discovering this information, when you're reading about it, are you blown away?
Yeah, blown away. I mean,
Do you remember the first article you read where you're like, what the hell? That's totally opposite what I thought.
Totally. A contradiction.
Yeah. I mean, well, the first thing that I started to do is I started to I started to think with skepticism over foods and products that have been in the human food supply for a shorter period of time. So rather than look at fairly new food products and dietary constructs as being innocent until proven guilty, I was like, we should start thinking more about these things as being guilty until proven innocent.
Oh, I like that mentality.
Yeah. And I realized that, you know, for pretty much the entirety of my life, I thought of grains and whole grains particularly as being additive to health. I used to really, you know, I would avoid white rice like the plague, but if you were to put a brown rice bowl in front of me, I'd eat it in its entirety and probably go back for seconds. And I realized that there's actually no biological necessity for grains. So this is something that we're only fed, spoon-fed, literally, no pun intended, as a sort of this modern construct that has no basis in scientific evidence. I mean, most of our dietary recommendations they stem from epidemiology. So nutrition science in humans is very difficult to do this kind of research.
Right.
Aside from population level evidence, we can look at populations, we can see how they eat, we can see how long they live, we can see their health spans, essentially, which is, you know, how long they're able to live free of chronic disease. And we can say, look, you know, people that live a long time, they eat X, they eat Y, they live Z. But I think what our nutritional guidelines have done, they've made the grave mistake of attributing causality to correlations. And that those correlations have really formed the basis of our nutritional guidelines,
right?
Which is really unfortunate.
Right. So let's feed this rat this chemical for 6 months. Oh, it's fine.
Yeah,
it didn't die.
Even besides that,
exactly.
The fat hypothesis was they actually took out a lot of important information to fit their theory of saturated fat causing heart disease, and that became national policy. This is one of the reasons why I'm so opposed to government guidelines for pretty much anything, but especially when it comes to nutrition, because when it becomes this guideline and you put it out nationally, like if you're off by a little bit and you make a mistake, that's going to cause a lot of problems
exactly.
with everybody, and it
hundreds
drives
of thousands of people.
Yeah, versus letting the market kind of decide, and there's always going to be mistakes made there too, but you find that, you know, there's more opportunities to figure out what works versus what doesn't work versus going to school. It was like I was having dinner last night with my parents, and you know, I was having this conversation with my mom, and she's like, yeah, when you eat meat, it needs to fit in the palm of your hand, and the majority of your food needs to be carbohydrates because that's what we teach in school. And I'm like, no, that's so wrong for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. But it's been fed to us for so long, and it's caused so many problems. When you started making these changes with your mom and her diet, did she start to notice improvements in her health?
Well, so, you know, when I came down from the mountain with all these insights in tow, and I became really interested in the ketogenic diet, because, again, I've been familiar with the ketogenic diet since 1998. So when I started to look at brain metabolism, and I came across the work of Mary Newport, who's a neonatologist who has been a really, I think, impactful pioneer in terms of spreading the word about the value of ketones for the Alzheimer's brain. I became, you know, familiar with her work, and I essentially tried to put my mom on a ketogenic diet. And I think, you know, the most I was able to keep her on it for were 2 weeks. When people develop Alzheimer's disease, there's a shift in food preference that occurs, where people that maybe never have had a sweet tooth begin to crave sweet, starchy foods.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And so this goes back to the type 3 diabetes hypothesis in the Alzheimer's brain. So the brain can use two fuels primarily to generate ATP, that is fat and glucose. Generally speaking, you know, for somebody on the standard American diet consuming 300 grams of carbohydrates per day, the brain is primarily using glucose to generate ATP. Glucose is sort of like the brain's gasoline. And as a byproduct of glucose metabolism, it creates free radicals. And what happens in a lot of these neurological conditions, especially Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, there's sort of a tilting of the scale where there's more oxidative stress happening in the brain than we can effectively mop up, so to speak. And glucose metabolism creates oxidative stress because it creates a lot of these free radicals. Ketones are considered to be sort of like the brain's electricity in that sort of glucose gasoline analogy, in that it's a much cleaner burning fuel source. And also, there's an inability of brains with Alzheimer's disease to properly metabolize or create ATP out of glucose. In fact, the Alzheimer's brain's ability to create ATP out of glucose is diminished by about 50%. So
they're starved of their main energy.
They're starved of their main energy source. And yet, interestingly, their ability to generate ATP through with ketones is actually not deterred by Alzheimer's disease, aging, or even certain genes that are well known to be Alzheimer's risk genes. And so, yeah, so I was like, okay, so we got to, you know, put my mom on a ketogenic diet to sort of supplement this sort of brain energy that is likely being lost in my mom. My mom, again, didn't have Alzheimer's disease, but there seems to be what's called glucose hypometabolism evident in a number of neurological conditions. And even even without having a neurological condition, carriers of the most well-defined Alzheimer's risk gene have reduced glucose metabolism in their brains, evident from the 20s. From a very young age, even way prior to symptoms. So I tried to put my mom on this ketogenic diet, and by the way, that's why that's why it's speculated that Alzheimer's disease patients have this craving for sugar, because
they need more of it.
They need more of it, which is ironic because those are these foods, especially in the modern food supply, are the exact kinds of foods that drive inflammation, which seem to promote this reduced inability of the brain to create energy. So it's like this, it becomes this vicious cycle. But at the end of the day, you know, putting a patient with dementia on such a rigorous dietary protocol, I mean, being on a ketogenic diet is not easy. It's really hard. It's a huge strain on the caregiver, and it's hard for the patient. And so at a certain point, I realized that I had to, take a step back, teach gently, but then take a step back because I was starting to get really emotionally invested in my mom's diet. And I would become upset when I would go to her house and I would see a bag of potato chips open on the counter, or that bag of Kind bars or whatever, you know, granola bars that have, you know, way too much sugar.
That's what I was seeking for. I knew that I had to, because it's so hard, man, when you got somebody who's doing it, because she's got a lot that's going on inside for her, man. She's probably depressed and sad and angry and frustrated, and then dealing with craving. I mean, there's got to be a million things going through her head. It's so hard to break through somebody like that. So what was that process like?
Dude, well, that's why I'm so sensitive to the struggle of the caregiver. I'm not my mom's caregiver, but, sometimes you hear people today because, you know, I mean, information on the fake news is real. You know, information on the internet can spread like wildfire. And there's a lot of people now in the health and wellness space throwing around the R word, reversed, when it comes to diseases like Alzheimer's disease. And I think it's very irresponsible, because when a patient has dementia, particularly when it's advanced,
damage is done, right?
I mean, these are diseases, again, that begin oftentimes decades before the first symptom. So I want to, you know, I tried to teach at first a little bit more, with a little bit more force. But at a certain point, I didn't want it to affect my mom's quality of life.
Relationship with her, right? You don't want her to hate you.
Exactly. Or the relationship that I have with my mom. I mean, at this point, anything that I could do to make my mom happy and to make her smile, I want to do. And I know that she's happiest when she's around me and my little brothers. And I don't want her to feel like, oh my God, I've got to hide this food from Max. You know, like, because I'm neurotic as hell when it comes to nutrition and the things that I eat and the supplements that I take and all that stuff. But you know, I don't expect other people to be
similar experience with me, again, with my parents. Like, I can't even talk about nutrition with them anymore because they get so angry because I'll go in their house and I'll start throwing things away. And it's like, okay, if I want to have a good relationship with my parents, I got to chill. I can't always be like this, you know?
Yeah.
Otherwise, I won't be able to connect with them anymore. What were some of the things that really shocked you the most as you went down this path and you wrote this book now? You wrote a book called Genius Foods, which was spurred on by this experience that you had with your mom. What were some of the things that you wrote about in your book that were kind of shocking to you or mind-blowing?
Well, I would say, definitely the notion that Alzheimer's disease begins in the brain decades before the first symptom. Alzheimer's disease is something that affects 5 million people today in the U.S., and those numbers are expected to explode in the coming years. And this is just one kind of dementia. I mean, there's a number of other neurological conditions. And with the oldest millennial now approaching 40, to me, it became very clear that this is something that young people need to talk about. And I'm not talking about in the context of younger people being caregivers. I'm talking about younger people carving out their own cognitive destiny decades from now. And over the course of the research and putting into practice all of the things that I was learning about, you know, from an evolutionary lens, the kind of diet that we might want to consume to help our brains not only survive but thrive. I started putting them into practice in my own life, and I noticed that my brain started working better as well. Mm. I mean, I mentioned to you guys I struggled with grades growing up. These are, you know, aspects of one's executive or one's cognitive abilities called executive function. And executive function is thought by some researchers to be more important in terms of a person's overall success, life success, than IQ. And this includes abilities like focus, being able to tune out distractions, planning, decision-making, aspects of one's personality, and even to some degree altruism and feeling connected with other people. These are all factors that are heavily mediated by the kinds of foods that we're eating and the ways that we're living our lives. And I noticed that my brain started to work better. It was almost as if my brain had downshifted as I started putting these practices, you know, into play in my own life. And I was like, okay, that's interesting.
Were there major foods that did that for you that you noticed, like, oh shit, when I cut that out and I introduced that, that was something that I wasn't doing before and I instantly noticed it? Like for me, when we started to just fast, that was a big difference. And when I made this shift, because I was a very high carbohydrate eater myself, especially when I was into competing, I was 400-600 grams of carbs a day. And my attitude was, oh, I've always been able to keep myself in shape. Why would I ever even fuck with a ketogenic diet? It just didn't appeal to me. But that attitude alone was what made me do it. I thought, well, that's a stupid reason for me not to see if it actually could improve my life. And we switched to ketogenic for a while. And man, that was mental clarity instantly was one of the first things that I noticed. And it was just by cutting out all the grains and stuff and bread and shit like that I used to have in my diet all the time. What did you notice first?
Yeah, well, some people tend to feel you know, an improvement in executive function when they do eat carbs and sugar. But it's not clear whether or not the carbs and sugar are actually improving a person's ability to think, or if when they're eating those carbs and sugar, they're essentially treating their own withdrawal from their last meal.
I would argue that.
Yeah, I would argue that as well. So once I started cutting out the grains and sugar from my diet, my energy levels definitely stabilized. And I mean, it was sort of like the tide in the harbor lifting all boats. I mean, I definitely felt like my energy levels were more stable and reliable and consistent throughout the day. I mean, I would have massive energy swings. And I, you know, I've always been metabolically healthy. I've never been overweight. And I was always in what I call the 1% of grain consumers. I was religious about consuming grains only in their whole grain form. And yet, nonetheless, my energy levels were like a roller coaster throughout the day. You know, I would start every day with a whole wheat bagel. I would be starving by lunch, probably end up having another like sandwich or something for lunch, or a brown rice bowl, which was like my favorite thing to eat. And then before dinner, you know, dried fruit snacks, you know, I remember I found these whole wheat cookies, and I would eat six of them at a time because they were whole wheat. So once I started cutting all those foods out of my diet, first of all, I was no longer a slave to my food. You know, I got to eat when I wanted. I essentially became fat adapted. So once you have that pipeline of fat up and running, I mean, we store fat for a reason. Our fat is there to be burned, right? Too many of us in the modern world, I think, stockpile fat and never allow the, you know, themselves to have the opportunity to burn it.
Such a great point.
Yeah. And so, you know, let your body burn fat. Your brain wants to burn fat. In fact, there's a really interesting thing that I learned over the course of the book, which the book is full of like these really interesting sidebars. And I think the one that I'm most proud of, there's a few that I'm proud of, but I really like the one where I talk about why human babies are born so fat. So a lot of people, you know, when a human baby is born fat, or sorry, when a human baby is born, they actually come with a body fat percentage that's higher than any mammal. So like, I think the body fat of a human baby rivals that of newborn baby seals. But why is that?
Interesting.
It's interesting, right?
It's not adorable too.
They're adorable. Yeah. We like to pinch that fat, but why is that fat there, right? So the human baby completes its cognitive development in the world. Unlike our closest relatives in the animal kingdom, you know, if you were to look at a chimp, when a newborn chimp is born, a chimp is born ripped. But a chimp is also born packed with a catalog of cognitive instincts and abilities that a human baby is not born with. A human baby's brain continues to develop in the real world. This is what many people call the fourth trimester, right? And it's also one of the reasons why I think humans have been able to accomplish as a species what humans have been able to accomplish. We're the most social species. We, you know, we team up, we build things together. So I think this is all owed to fat. It's believed that the fat that a baby comes packaged with is literally like a Mophie for the developing brain. A Mophie is sort of like an iPhone's backup battery. That fat is actually a backup battery for the developing brain. A newborn spends most of its time in ketosis, and this is to supply the brain with energy, because you might know that the human brain, the adult brain uses about 25% of our base metabolic rate. So 25% of every, you know, all the things that you eat, every breath you take is going to create energy in your brain, right? But the newborn baby's brain, the brain is actually using 90% of that baby's metabolism.
Wow. So, all fascinating shit.
It's like a brain attached
to
like chubbiness. You know what I mean? It's just fat attached to a brain, basically.
Right. Exactly. That's exactly what it is. So that brain is literally that human baby is literally a walking, developing brain. And that fat is there to supply the energy in the form of ketones to the brain. In fact, if you look at mother's milk, which is arguably the best food for a newborn.
High fat.
It's high fat. It's rich in saturated fat and even medium chain triglycerides, which basically push additional ketones into the brain. So that baby is spending a lot of time.
Wow. I did not know that. Yeah. That's fucking fascinating.
If you look at, here's a statistic that blew me away years ago, is I learned that if you're a lean athlete, you store about 30,000 calories worth of potential ketones that you can run off of. At any given moment, the most you'd store in terms of glycogen is about 6,000 calories. So in terms of an energy source, like even if you're lean, you've got way more fat that you can call upon to utilize for energy than you can with glucose. Like we're designed to run off of fat, and probably because we were hunters and we killed something, we ate it, and then we had to wait until we killed the next animal. And so we went for long periods of time without food.
Absolutely. And our ability to store sugar is really limited. I mean, you can only store about 100 and 125 grams of glycogen in your liver, maybe 400, 500 in your muscle, but your muscle can only use the glycogen that it has stored. So basically your brain's only backup source of glucose is the liver, which only contains about 100 grams of glucose,
which you could easily tap out in a 1 hour sporting event. You're done with that.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. But we have a virtually unlimited capacity to store fat. And again, the brain loves to use fat for fuel. This is something that we're elegantly designed to do. And the minute insulin, which is the hormone that becomes stimulated when we consume, you know, carbs, predominantly, becomes elevated, ketone production comes to a grinding halt. So you can imagine your average American consuming more than 300 grams of carbs per day. First of all, the brain is given no choice but to use glucose, which, as we mentioned, is a dirty fuel.
Do you think this is the major problem of obesity right now? I mean, I think it's so fascinating that we continue to get smarter and evolve, but yet these diseases continue to see a rise. Do you think this is the main reason why?
I think, yeah. I mean, I think definitely we do less leisure time recreational activity than ever before in history. We're more sedentary than ever before. We're eating more carbs than ever before. And usually these carbs come in the form of ultra processed foods, which are hyper palatable. So they're basically prone to overconsumption. And when we eat these carbs, because we're so sedentary, because, you know, very few of us, relatively speaking, are hitting the gym, we've got nowhere to dispose of that glucose. So, I mean, the more muscle you have on your body, the greater your ability to dispose of glucose. This is an incredibly important function of muscle. I mean, aside from just making you look better naked, right, and helping you lift heavier things, like muscle basically serves the function of being banks for glucose, so that when you do decide to eat that brown rice bowl or overindulge on fruit, which we very likely probably did seasonally as hunter-gatherers, it gives you an ability to store those carbs.
God, literally in the context of modern life, we've told people to do the wrong things. Mm-hmm. Like when it comes to exercise, and we've said this so often on the show, probably, and this is in the context of modern lifestyle, the most important form of exercise you could be partaking in is exercise that builds muscle. Because of that, because you're surrounded by hyper palatable carbohydrates and processed foods, muscle directly combats the insulin resistance and the problems that arise from consuming too many carbohydrates far more than doing cardiovascular activity, which is a very manual way of trying to burn, you know, glycogen. It doesn't really improve your body's ability to store it.
Definitely. And there's a strong relationship actually between upper body strength and lower body strength and brain health. So, I mean, having more muscle in your body is really important. Again, for making sure that your blood sugar stays within healthy levels to, you know, obviously promote insulin sensitivity, which is really important. Also, interestingly, the same stimulus that makes your muscles bigger works on your brain cells. So we now know, thanks to animal studies, that high-intensity interval training actually stimulates mitochondrial biogenesis in your muscle tissue. You create more mitochondria, but this also occurs in the brain as well. So really important. Going back to the brain's metabolic health, I mean, mitochondria are sort of like the, you know, the cornerstones of healthy brain metabolism. And we can support them by doing high-intensity.
We've traded acute disease for chronic disease is what's happened in modern life. And I don't think people realize that the reason why we eat the way we do is humans a long time ago discovered, well, in the context of all of human history, it's actually quite recent, we discovered that we could plant things and grow them and, you know, eat them. And so we made this huge shift in how we eat. And when you look at the crops that we grow here in modern Western societies, these are the crops that we've learned to grow the most of and, you know, to just make them the most efficient. So we eat a lot of corn, a lot of soy, a lot of wheat. And it's not because those were always a part of human, you know, history or were corn. It's because those are the easiest to grow and we were able to stop starvation from it, which is a great problem to solve. But now we've got this other problem where if that's all you eat or if that's a majority of what you eat, we're encountering chronic health problems like never before. Who are some of the people that you interviewed and talked to that to put your book together? Who are some of the experts that you interviewed and worked with?
Well, one of the first people that I interviewed was Suzanne DeLamonte, who coined the term type 3 diabetes, which has since been referenced over and over and over again in medical literature and lay literature alike. I've interviewed Dr. Alessio Fasano, who's one of the, he's the founder of the Center for Celiac Research at Harvard. He's one of the leading experts on gluten and autoimmunity. I interviewed one of the researchers that has basically given us the strongest evidence to date that our cognitive health is something that we have a say in when it comes to diet and lifestyle. Over the course of the book, I've actually contributed to research at the Alzheimer's Prevention Clinic in New York at Weill, Cornell Medicine.
Wow.
And one of my mentors, who is the director there, his name is Richard Isaacson. He's a good friend of mine. And we've collaborated on research and traded notes as well. So, I mean, I tried to call information from everywhere. You know, if it pertains to having a better brain, I'm interested. I'm obsessed. And I tried to synthesize it all in Genius Foods. It also, aside from dementia prevention, I'm really interested. So, you know, I noticed that my brain started working better. I started to really look into this topic. There's not quite a name for it. I call it cognitive optimization, but it really is this burgeoning line of research that looks at how various foods and nutrients affect people that are cognitively healthy, young, cognitively healthy people. They're not typically a population that's studied, but there's really interesting research on how certain nutrients can actually improve the way that your brain functions in the here and now, even if you're young, which is kind of striking because we already consider young people to be at their peak of cognitive abilities. So
what are you finding?
Well, you know, most people in this country are deficient in at least one essential nutrient. And these nutrients are readily contained in the whole foods that we're not eating. So, you know, take dark leafy greens, which I think the CDC found that only 10% of Americans are consuming an adequate amount of vegetables. These foods contain really powerful chemicals called carotenoids, which I sort of highlight in the book. In particular, lutein and zeaxanthin, which are found in vegetables and egg yolks and fat of grass-fed cows, because these carotenoids are found in plants, which cows eat. When cows are fed corn, they don't embed the carotenoids in their fat because corn has very few. So when you get a grass-fed cow, one of the main health benefits of eating grass-fed meat is that the carotenoids that these cows basically ingest when they consume grass embeds themselves into their fat. So these carotenoids basically, they are really important for eye health. They help shield the macula against, potentially damaging frequencies of light. But it's also been recently shown that these same carotenoids actually make their way up to the brain where they can boost something called visual processing speed. So this is really important for athletic performance and just overall, you know, the way that you are able to visually take in a stimuli, process it, and respond to it. it's a key, you know, aspect, I would say, of your cognitive function. And University of Georgia researchers found that in young, healthy college-age students, they were able to boost their visual processing speed by 20% when supplementing with lutein and zeaxanthin, these two plant-based carotenoids, which are readily found in kale, spinach, avocado, and also in they're what make pastured egg yolks look so orange. And so, yeah, these carotenoids, you know, really important in terms of boosting your health. And coincidentally, although I don't think it's a coincidence, these same foods that are high in these carotenoids also are associated with reduced brain aging. So going back to the dementia space, I mean, it's all related. Mm-hmm. So, again, going back to like dot connecting, we really connect the dots, I think, in a cool way in the book. And then also we make the leap to this other burgeoning field called nutritional psychiatry, which to me is really interesting. Growing up in New York City, I would always struggle with seasonal affective disorder. I would get really depressed come wintertime. And so mental health is something that's become really important to me. You know, and also I think everybody, just as a natural part of living in 2018, occasionally deals with depression, anxiety, things like that. So I document in the book really interesting research on how food can improve mood. I talk about, and I've interviewed the researcher who published the first ever randomized control trial to use a diet as an antidepressant, published in 2017.
We just had Michaela Peterson on the show. This is Jordan Peterson's daughter, and she had severe depression since the age of 12 and autoimmune issues and whatnot. And through diet, she was able to go off almost all of her medications, especially her antidepressant drugs. And she had to go on a radical diet. She actually only eats meat at the moment. And I do think there's an autoimmune component there, but you're hearing more and more of it, but there's always so much pushback, especially when you talk about the psychological effects of food. What's that been like for you? Have you been getting a lot of pushback from people?
I mean, to be totally honest, no, not a lot of pushback
That's
at
great.
All. Yeah. Which I'm really happy about.
It's the way you deliver it. You don't deliver it in a very dogmatic way. You know, every time you've said something, which I really appreciate, because sometimes when people come and we all agree that for the most part, a majority of people are over consuming carbohydrates, but at the same time too, we don't demonize the food. If you're a fucking sports athlete and you're moving and you're burning, you know, 7,000 calories a day, by all means, you know, carbohydrates could probably serve you, but for the most part. So I think it's the way
you do it. And for maximum performance, you know, we know studies show carbohydrates probably will make you perform a little bit better, but there's a difference between optimal health and optimal performance, and many times they don't necessarily connect.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I really want to, one of my goals is to try to get this message out beyond what I call the paleosphere. You know, like I think it's so important to not just speak to the echo chamber of your social media networks and really get this information out to the people that need it. So I think about like the audience that I talked to on the Dr. Oz show, for example, which I've been really lucky to get to talk to. You know, when making a recommendation to people, I have to be cognizant of the fact that 66% of the U.S. population is either overweight or obese. You know, 50% are either diabetic or pre-diabetic, which is essentially glucose intolerance. So do I think that grains are toxic like many people would suggest in the paleo world today? No, not for somebody if you're working out and you're going to the gym and you're not eating a whole lot of processed foods and the like. But for the majority of people in the Western world, which, you know, have become basically intolerant of glucose. Yeah, probably. Like, why are you eating grains, which are basically energy dense, you know, chains of glucose stored in the endosperm of these plants, when you could be eating dark leafy greens, which are full of micronutrients that we know that you're not getting.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So
what is it? What is if you could you distill like what a healthy diet would look like for the brain?
Yeah. Well, so, and you touched on this a little bit earlier. You know, I started using like the evolutionary lens to try to figure out what diet we might have consumed in the time in which our brains evolved and how we might be able to emulate that diet today. So we know that for 200,000 years, since we've been anatomically modern humans, if not, you know, long before that, the land was our buffet, right? And there's 50,000 edible plant species around the world. And yet, as of 10,000 years ago, when we became essentially slaves to the handful of crops that we could domesticate, we essentially turned our backs on that diet, which paved the way for the fact that today our diets are dominated by three plants, okay? Wheat, corn, and rice. So again, these plants help to prevent starvation and help to grow the species by providing a really cheap source of calories. But they're very nutrient dense. And so over time, our brains actually lost the volumetric equivalent of a tennis ball. This has been well documented. And
oh, repeat that. A lot of people don't know that.
Yeah. So our brains actually lost volume. So
they're smaller.
Yeah. So we ate a certain way for, you know, 100,000, 180,000 years that led to the evolution of our brains, this magnificent supercomputer, which we are each heir to today. We turned our backs on that diet and our brains shrank. So I was like, okay, well, we've had grains for a relative blip on the radar in terms of our evolutionary timescale for about 10,000 years. So clearly they're not essential. There's no essential grain out there, and grains don't provide nutrients that you can't find more efficiently anywhere else. So the first thing that I did was I cut grains out, at least initially, to see how I would feel, because I realized that these are not needed for the brain. And I started to look at the nutrients that the brain needs to thrive. So, I mean, we have a handful of nutrients that we know that the body needs to avoid what are called deficiency diseases. So these are the 42, you know, vitamins and minerals that we know that we need. But a lot of the recommended daily allowances for these vitamins and minerals are set only to avert, again, deficiencies. So vitamin D we know is the, you know, whatever, I think it's like 400 or 800 international units that we're supposed to intake every day is really set only so that a population might avoid rickets, for example. But I started to really look at, you know, all of these nutrients, the kinds of foods that they're found in. And I was like, well, you know, dark leafy greens are really the best that you can get when it comes to just a broad array of micronutrients that we know that we need. Magnesium, for example, folate, I've become, you know, especially for people that carry the MTHFR gene mutation. Folate's really helpful in terms of your body's methylation cycle and keeping an amino acid called homocysteine low. When you have elevated homocysteine, it actually accelerates the rate of brain atrophy. And by eating folate, by eating it or supplementing with it particularly, and also importantly, you've got to, you know, do this in tandem with vitamin B12 and vitamin B6. Really important. And these are found in, folate is named for foliage. That's where the name comes from. So dark leafy greens, I really started to build my diet more around those, you know, kale, spinach, arugula. Arugula, going back to heart health for a second, arugula is the top source of nitrates in the diet. Really important for the healthy functioning of your vasculature. So I started eating more arugula, more spinach, things like that. Then I started looking at fats. What are the healthy fats to consume? So really good evidence on extra virgin olive oil. At the population level, extra virgin olive oil is the hallmark of the Mediterranean diet. They consume lots of extra virgin olive oil. But as we mentioned, you know, that's a part of a dietary pattern. We can't tease out from that kind of research whether or not extra virgin olive oil is causally involved in the Mediterranean dietary pattern, or it's just sort of there as a, you know, just an aside.
Right.
But actually, there are really good studies being done on extra virgin olive oil, both animal trials, and there was a very really good long-term, large population randomized control trial done out of Barcelona, Spain, called the PREDIMED trial, where they actually put patients on three diets. One was a low-fat diet, which is still widely recommended, and two versions of the Mediterranean diet, which is already high in fat. But one was supplemented with even one version of the Mediterranean diet was supplemented with even more extra virgin olive oil, about a liter additional per week. And they found that at the end of, I believe it was six.
That's a lot.
It's a lot. It's a lot. It's like 8,000 calories.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That's what I do. Yeah. I'm Italian. We basically bathe in it. So
you bathe in it. Yeah.
Gargle it. Yeah.
I mean, yeah, they use it. I mean, in the Mediterranean regions of the world, they use it as a sauce. They pour it on things. They cook in it. I mean, it's like they don't show your mother like a tube of corn oil or a bottle of corn oil. They're probably like, what is this?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, it's got no flavor.
Yeah.
So, Max, walk me through for the audience that's listening, we're going to make some really cool YouTube videos along these lines. But walk me through like a morning to night normal day of eating and your choices, and then why you took those choices. And you're covering some of them right now, but like walk me through a day and why you choose those foods.
Cool. So, I mean, I wake up in the morning, I drink a glass of water. If I'm doing a particularly low carb, you know, iteration of my diet, I'll throw some mineral salt in there. You know, when you drop insulin, which you do very, very easily on a low carb diet, your kidneys spill sodium. So sodium is a very important electrolyte. It's a nutrient. It's been demonized again by the modern, you know, dietary guidelines, but very important and very actually one of the probably most noticeable aspects of my protocol is when I'm doing very low carb to add a little bit of salt. It gives me, you know, it keeps my blood pressure up, like, but not not, you know, up in a negative way. It just keeps it so that I feel like I've got a sense of energy, and also adds in some other trace minerals as well. About an hour, two hours after I wake up, I'll have my first meal of the day. I don't like to eat first thing in the morning. You know, first thing in the morning, we have a hormonal milieu that wants to burn fat. Cortisol is at its peak that it's going to be throughout the day, first thing in the morning, right? And cortisol is the body's chief catabolic hormone. It's there to liberate stored sugar from your liver. It's there to liberate stored fats that your brain loves to use. I mean, most people, when they wake up, they're already in sort of a mild ketosis.
How much does drinking coffee kill that?
Well, I don't think it kills it.
It helps it, I think.
Yeah.
Does it help it?
Yeah.
It'll accelerate
coffee. Coffee, yeah. Coffee encourages ketosis.
So why not drink that? Are you not a coffee drinker or?
Well, I do drink coffee. No, I do drink coffee. I try not to drink it for, you know, 40. I try to wait until that cortisol, that peak morning cortisol spike begins to subside before I have my first cup. But yeah, I do drink black coffee. I'm a big fan. And the research on coffee, I think, is very supportive of it as being a sort of health tonic. Again, within like sort of a range, right? We were talking about this before we started recording, but some is probably better than none, especially if you're not sensitive to it. But too much doesn't necessarily equate to better health either, right?
Yeah, that's right, Justin.
Yeah.
Judgmental.
So I try not to like mess with that hormonal milieu too much. I want to, you know, allow my body to burn fat, lower, you know, liberate stored fuels. And then I'll break my fast with my first meal of the day, which usually, so if I've, sometimes I'll do like a morning workout. And if I've had a really intense workout and I want to like get that glycogen back in my muscles, I'll have, you know, maybe a sweet potato with my food or, you know, maybe I'll go for some rice. I don't always do this, but I do think, you know, when you're trying to maintain, high intensity output, really important to have that glycogen in your muscles. You know, we hit a certain threshold in high intensity work where we need glycolysis really to push through a lift. So, but then again, I'm not a power lifter. I'm not really into bodybuilding so much anymore. So I don't always do this, but, if I hadn't had a big workout, I'll go for what I call a huge fatty salad. So I'll really pack a bowl with dark leafy greens, douse it with extra virgin olive oil, you know, lots of color in there because, again, those carotenoids are really important and they're plant pigments. Maybe throw an egg in. You need fat because carotenoids are fat soluble. So if you're eating a bowl of dark leafy greens with fat-free dressing, which so many people do, you're actually, your absorption of these most, some of the most important compounds in those greens becomes negligible.
What a great point.
Yeah. It becomes negligible. Whereas by adding fat to that salad, it becomes sort of like a slip and slide for these nutrients to enter your system. Then I try not to snack too much. And by the way, I never count calories. I always eat until I'm full. Sometimes I'll go back for seconds. I think when you're eating whole foods like this, you know, and especially when you put a focus on protein, you know, getting that feeling of satiety is so important. And protein is the most satiating macronutrient. So this is really key. We can get into why. I think it's really interesting. But moving on to the day, I think, you know, I try not to snack so much, but, you know, if I'm around the house, sometimes I do. I always reach for nuts, very important. And dark chocolate is what I call a genius food, you know, rich in these flavanols that have been shown to be really beneficial to the brain. Also a great source of magnesium, very important. 50% of the U.S. population doesn't consume enough magnesium. So, you know, I like to tell people if it's as easy as eating more dark chocolate, you know, have at it. And then for dinner, you know, again, I like to eat a lot. So I'll usually, you know, roast a piece of fish or have a grass-fed beef burger or something without the bun, throw it on either a bed of dark leafy greens or I'll roast up some vegetables. Chicken, you know, I love to, you know, go for like an organic rotisserie chicken. I love to bake up some chicken legs really good. I used to go only for white meat, you know, when I was like really into the sort of lean protein thing, but actually chicken legs are a great source of collagen protein. Collagen is really important as well. You know, we used to eat the whole animal. Now we only eat muscle meat, but when you eat like a chicken leg, cartilage tends to be found around the joints of animals. And so you get a lot of that. Really important.
Yeah, I think a lot of people don't realize when you stick to whole natural foods and you avoid grains on top of it, your body's natural systems of satiety work pretty well.
Yeah.
You tend to not overeat as a result of that. I think it's harder to overeat. Of course, there's lots of other reasons why people overeat. There could be emotional reasons for it. But when your foods, and this is just through my experience, I trained people for over 20 years, and when they would stick to whole natural foods without counting calories or macros, many times, not always, but many times, they would lose lots of body fat just because their bodies are telling them when it's time to stop eating and when it's time to start eating. Whereas when you introduce all these hyper-palatable processed foods, you're just hijacking the shit out of that. You just want to keep eating, and that's what those foods are designed to do, by the way. They're engineered to do that for you, to make you hungry.
Absolutely. I mean, you could do a little thought experiment in your own kitchen. You could take a baked potato or a spoonful of sugar and put it in your mouth and see how prone those two foods are to overconsumption. You're probably not going to want to overconsume just straight up sugar put into your mouth. And a baked potato by itself is not very good. But the minute you mix that sugar with eggs and flour and you create cookie dough, oh my God, it's like the 4th of July in your brain's reward center,
right?
When you take a baked potato or, you know, try eating a stick of butter, it's not that good. But the minute you combine the two, it becomes what's called hyper palatable. It pushes your brain to a bliss point beyond which you can't control yourself. I mean, we can do this in our own kitchens, but food manufacturers are super aware of that.
Yes, because they know. Mastered it.
Yeah, because they know that, you know, when it comes to these hyper-processed foods, once you pop, you can't stop, right? So,
do you get a lot of people asking for, like, recommendations for supplementation? And like, how do you feel particularly about, like, this boom in people trying to get, like, you know, these supplements to increase your cognitive performance.
Oh, like nootropics. And things like that. Yeah.
And then they have a shitty diet.
Right, exactly.
Yes. Like
they're avoiding that topic.
100%. Well, that's it. I mean, I'm not a big fan. And there's, for most people, I would say there's so many low-hanging fruits in people's diets and lifestyles that to throw a supplement on top of that, I think is bad news. I like to say, I mean, my official answer to that whenever people ask me is that, you know, food is the ultimate nootropic. So I'm not a big, I never take any brain supplements. I just, you know, I focus on foods. I mean, drinking coffee, has caffeine. Caffeine's a nootropic. Most of the nootropics that you'll pay a lot of money for basically are just like jacked up caffeine cocktails with some other things that are probably not super effective.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Who do you hope to reach with your book, or what do you hope to accomplish with it?
I mean, I think it's, you know, I think it's relevant to every person. I mean, I really do. I think, you know, whether or not you have Alzheimer's in your family or any kind of the human brain is highly delicate and damage prone, particularly in the modern food environment. And so, you know, insofar as our brain really is the battery that makes everything that we love possible and helps us to connect with one another and loved ones, I think, you know, it's something that we need to protect as if our life depends on it, because it does. I also think that with so many people today struggling with memory problems, and, you know, 1 in 6 adults is now on a psychiatric drug, 1 in 7 younger people between the ages of 18 and 39 complain of memory problems. I mean, I think, you know, our brains are clearly not working the way that they ought to. Too often today, you know, proper brain function is a privilege afforded to too few, when I think it should be a right. I mean, if you're alive, you are literally the heir to this incredible flagship product of Darwinian evolution. It should work the way it's meant to. And so, you know, I really hope it's a book that I think everybody can read. It's written so that everybody will be able to get something from it. But in particular, if you do have a family history of dementia, if you're scared of cognitive decline, of Alzheimer's disease, I wrote it to be the ultimate tome to dementia prevention. And in a way that I think is probably going to be more impactful, I hope it's going to be more impactful than current books that are out there about dementia prevention, because it's not packaged in the language of dementia prevention. So that's my secret, like, Trojan horse goal, is that people read it wanting to learn about how to increase energy, how to increase focus, cognitive resilience, all that stuff. And in the end, inadvertently end up preventing their own dementia. That's my, like, secret goal, because trust me, man, I've, like, seen the monster that is dementia. I see it every day. It's fucking horrible. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to see that. You know, if I can, first of all, save one other person from becoming a victim, then I'll feel like my job has been done. But it's a huge area of confusion for most people. There's a lot of misinformation out there. And, you know, I just think that getting this message out to young people, people that are not typically attuned to dementia-related content, that's why I don't really use the term dementia in terms of its marketing. And I'm trying to really steer the conversation in terms of prevention because again, people, it begins in the brain decades before the first symptom.
Mm. And people don't realize just how expensive it is to treat Alzheimer's and dementia. Dementia is one of the most expensive. It's one of the biggest costs that we incur with our healthcare costs. And it you know, if you combine that with like diabetes, it will bankrupt us 100%. We're on a trajectory to become bankrupt if we don't figure this out soon. And I think I'm glad you're putting out a book like this. I'm glad more of this information is going out, because this is not just a problem for out of shape, unhealthy people. This is a problem for everybody, even if you are healthy and fit, because at some point you might have to pay for all this stuff, or at least you're going to, you know, incur the side effects of this, you know, economy crashing because people are just not healthy. Who's going to take care of all these people? Who's going to pay for it all?
You're so right.
Yeah. Anyway, I appreciate you writing this book. I appreciate you coming on the show, man.
Dude,
great conversation.
Thank you so much for having me. It really means a lot.
Yeah, great. No, I'm looking forward to the YouTube. So make sure you guys check out that, because we'll definitely put up some cool videos with Max for sure. He's got a ton of good information.
Definitely. Thanks again, Max.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now, plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes, and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.